Hello everyone, let's now move to the second part of the poem, Progress of Poesy. In the first stanza of the first part, we have seen that we have already discussed that the poet talks about the source or origin of the poetry and how it moves from the Greek Mount Helicon in the voice of Greek poets like Horace. Now in the second stanza, he talks about the effects of music. So he says, "Oh, sovereign of the willing soul, oh, sovereign, supreme of the willing soul, the souls that produce desires. So the supreme power that has power, controlling power of over the desiring souls, willing souls. So this is an invocation to the muses or goddess of poetry. So, O muse, sovereign of the willing soul, means this is an invocation to the poetry, the goddess of poetry or all kinds of poetry. Parent of sweet and solemn breathing airs, enchanting shell. Parent, who is the producer of sweet and solemn breathing air, sweet and solemn, both kind of sweet and serious kind of breathing airs, breathing music, breathing, creating environment. So, enchanting shell, the sullen cares, enchanting shell, the shell here is mentioned for lyre, who is used for enchantment, and the sullen cares, the annoying fears. So, lyre, which was actually invented by Hermes by tortoise shell, that's why he has been saying enchanting shell. Shell is a upper cover of the tortoise, which is the main manufacturing element of lyre, that is the musical instrument. So, O muse, in the first three lines he says, O muse, you are a producer of sweet and solemn notes of music, and you have perfect dominion over the human heart, which willingly bows to you, and the lyre on which you play gives you enchanting sounds. It gives out enchanting sounds. The sullen cares, the annoying cares, cares is personified here. The cares which are sullen, which are actually annoying, which makes us annoy. And frantic passion, here the soft control. And frantic passions and wild passions of human beings, they hear the soft control of the poetry, the soft control of the music. So they are controlled by the poetry. He wants to say that all the annoying cares and wild passions of human beings are brought under control by the gentle influence of music or lyre. On Thracia's hills, the lord of war has curbed the fury of his car. On Thracia's hill, now here is the reference to the Mars, who is the god of war or lord of war according to the Greek mythology. So, the lord of war, Mars, by hearing on Thracia's hill, on the hills of Thracia, which is considered as his home, hears the soft voice on the hills of Thracia, and which is actually his home, and he has curbed the fury of his car, he has restrained the fury, the tempestuous chariot of his own. Means he's very much furious because he's the lord of war, and he has to be in very, you know, fury kind of passion, otherwise he will not be able to fight or invoke the spirit of fighting. So he has curbed, he has controlled, or he has restrained the fury of his car, the fury of his chariot, by hearing the gentle influence of music. So the music or the poetry which has a supreme power, a controlling power over the willing souls of human emotions, human souls, the desiring, the souls which are producing desires are controlled by the supreme power of poetry. It has a supreme power, it is a controlling power, poetry, or well, let's say music. Like whenever we are in a, you know, in a particular kind of mood, we hear to a particular kind of music, and that actually soothes us, actually it calms us, cools us. So That is the supreme power, the supreme power that can control the emotions, and that is the producer of sweet and solemn breathing. All kind of breathing airs, all kind of environment are being produced by poetry and enchanting shells, and it also plays lyre on which the music is played or the poetries are being played, and it gives enchanting sounds which give, you know, fascinating sounds. And these fascinating sounds have the quality to control the annoying fears, the sullen cares, the annoying cares or annoying fears, and the frantic passions and the wild passions. They are also controlled by the soft sound of the music. And in this series, Thracia or Claude, Thracia's hill, which are occupied or which are aborted, which is an abode of Lord of War, that is Mars, are also resounded by the poetry or the music. And the musical enchantments has the quality to control the restrain or to control the furious movement of Mars, who is considered as the god of war. So he is associated with, actually in classic Indian literature, he is associated with Thrace. That why it is said that Thracia's hill. Okay. And dropped his thirsty lens at thy command, and dropped, and he drops the bloodthirsty spear. Lance is the spear at thy command, because of the command of the music. So on the command of the music, the on Thracia's hill, even the Lord of Wars is so much enchanted and so much fascinated and so much engrossed in the music that he decides not to fight, and he drops his bloodthirsty spear, which is ready to kill many people. Okay. Perching on the sceptered hand of Jove, thy music lulls the feathered king. And perching, sitting or resting on the sceptered hand, the hand holding the rod of authority. Sceptered hand, the hand which holds the rod of authority. Now here he wants to draw the image of Jove, or the supreme god in Greek mythology, that he is sitting and he is carrying a rod, which is the rod of authority. So he is holding that rod of authority in his hand, and on the top of it is sitting an eagle. Okay, because eagle is the symbol of, you know, anger, furiousness, murder and all. It's a vulture. Of Jove, thy music lulls the feathered king. Thy music, your music, has the power to lull, to make sleep, or to tranquilize the wild eagle, which has dropping plumes and halting wings. The feathered king, the king which has feathered. Now, if you have seen the eagle, it has very long wings, very, very large wings, and they are being lulled. So eagle, when it's sitting on the scepter rod of Jove, it is not in the fighting position, or it is not in the position of praying. Rather, it is in position of as if it is sleeping. So music has the quality, music has the temper to control the wings of eagle. So with ruffled plumes and flagging wings, quenched in dark clouds of slumber lie. So the eagle, it has ruffled plumes. The plumes, its wings, which are actually ruffled, actually disturbed, because they are not spread, and flagging wings and slowing down. Wings which are coming slowing down, which are disturbed and slowing down. It's in position as if it is coming down. So the eagle, as it listens to the voice of the poetry, the muses, or the it listens to some song or the poetry, it is it has been tranquilized, and it has the wings, the plumes which are dropping, and wings that are halting and coming down. So quench in the dark clouds of slumber lie the terror of his beak and lightnings of his eye. And as the eagle listens to the voice of Muses, the terror of its cruel beak, because its beak is a symbol of cruelty, and glitter of its fierce eyes are subdued as if lost in the thick folds of sleep, as if it is going to sleep. It has been heard to a lullaby and it's going to sleep soon. So here it's the power of music, the power of poetry, the power of harmony, that how it has the power to control each and everything which has been, which comes in its way. Okay, so here ends the second stanza. So now moving towards the third stanza of the first part, third and the last stanza of the first part of the poem, which is again talk, which again talks about the power of muses and how it affects the feeling and emotion of love. Also, in the second paragraph, it was talking about controlling the passions of fear, the passion of anger, the passion of fury, the passion of war, and now how it controls, how music controls the passion of love also, the emotion of love also. So thee the voice, the dance obey, thee the voice, yours is the voice, the power of the voice, the dance obey, the human voice and the dancing movements of human body, they obey you. Thee the voice, you are the voice of the human bodies which they sing, and you are the voice to they obey, to they obey when they actually dance. Temper to the wobbled lay, and temper the answers to the wobbled lay, to the wobbled lay, to the songs which are sung. Lays are sung, songs which are wobbled, which are sung by you, by the muses, or by poetry. So, our muse, that the songs sung by you are attuned into themselves, and human voice, the human beings, they listen to them and they dance over those songs or those poetries, means the dancing movements are being controlled by the muses. Over Italia's velvet green, the rosy crown, lovers are seen. Over Italia's velvet green. Now, Italia is a town in Crete, and the people in this town are worshippers of Aphrodite or Venus, that is the goddess of love. Groove in Italia was particularly sacred to Venus. So, and in Milton's Lycidas, we have the temper to wobble lay. So, there is a similar kind of quote in Milton's Lycidas, where he says temper to the autumn flute. So, when Grace says that the power of harmony to produce all the graces of motion in the body, when he says the dance body, there was a comment by some Mrs. Garrick, who said that, who was actually a famous dancer, she remarked that nobody had ever understood dancing like Gray in this description, that how can we dance over a poetry. And Pindar actually had written, to whom Gray follows, that golden lyre, they are that are owned alike by Apollo and the violet tressed muse, thou lyre which the footstep herewith as if beginneth the glad dance, lyre whose notes the singers obey, whenever with by thy quivering strings thou preparest to strike up the prelude of the chord leading overture. This is actually what Pindar says about the power of muses. So let's talk about the effect on dancers, or the effect on the lovers. Okay. So, the human voice and the dancing movements of human body obey you, O muse, and attune themselves to the songs sung by you. Over Italia's velvet green, over the town of Italia, the velvet green lands of the fields in Italia, that is actually situated in Cyprus or Crete, winged the rosy crowned lovers are seen. Lovers which are crowned with roses, the winged cupids. Actually, there is the reference of cupids. We have seen the images of Cupid, the winged cupids who attend upon Venus, who wear crowns of roses, and they may be seen on the velvet green fields of Italia in Cyprus. On Cytherea's day, on day of Cytherea, that is sacred to Venus, when handed in these lands, Venus was said to have landed on Cytherea, an island off the south coast of Laconia, after her birth in the sea, and she is therefore called Cytherean or Cytherea or Cythera. So on the day of Cythera or Cytherea's day or Cytherean day, people in this town, they worship Venus, and this is actually celebrated as a festival. So with antique sports and blue-eyed pleasures, sports which are actually quaint or fantastic, and blue-eyed pleasures, and pleasures which are carrying blue eyes, because Cupid, they are, the image of Cupid is a beautiful beautiful men carrying wings and rosy crowns on their heads, and they have blue eyes. So winged cupids who attend upon Venus, they are the worshippers of Venus, because they are the they all symbolize love, and Venus is goddess of love. Who wear crowns of roses, they can be seen on velvet greens of Italia on the day which is sacred to Venus. These cupids are seen in the company of and they are in mood of antique sports, and they are having blue-eyed pleasures. They are blue-eyed. So here, merry figures and blue-eyed personifications of pleasure, leaping about with light and carefree steps, frisking light and frolling measures. They are moving in a light and carefree steps with the music. Now pursuing, now retreating. Now pursuing, now retreating. Sometimes they are moving forward, and sometimes they are coming backward. So sometimes they are frisking, they are jumping, sometimes they are frolic, they are merry in mood, and sometimes they move to the measures, to the rhythms, and sometimes they pursue, and sometimes they retreat. So these are all the movements of dance. Okay, they move backwards, they move forward, and they come together in last circle. These are the movements of dance. Now in circling troops they meet. Now they meet in circling crowd or large numbers or large groups of circle, to brisk notes in cadence beating, to very brisk, very quick notes in cadence, in music or in rhythm beats of the music. It's okay. Glance their many twinkling feet and look at. You should look at. They should glittering feet. Their feet, which glitter. Glittering variety. They have glittering feet, which are various kind. We are various in their quality. They dance. They keep moving with the music. Quick music. Slow melting strains. Their queens approach declare, and slow and soft notes of music strains music. They announce the approach of their queen. Wherever she turns, the graces homage pay, and wherever she turns, wherever she moves, graces. Now graces are the daughters of Gaius. There are three daughters of Gaius. They are called Euphrosyne, Aglaia, and Thalia, and they were believed to add to the refinement of life by their sweetness and gentleness. So they are the three ladies attending for Venus. Excuse me. So they are ready to pay their homage to their darling or their guardian lady. With arms sublime that float upon the air, in gliding state she wins her easy way. With arms sublime, the raised arms, the arms which are raised high, and that float upon the air, that move upon the air, in gliding state, in flying state, she wins her easy way. She moves her easy way. Over her warm cheek and rising bosom move, and she walks with smooth and effortless step, as if she were gliding, with her arms raised upward and floating upon the air, and on the warm cheek, on the and her bosom breast which moves the bloom of young desire and purple light of love. So there is a bloom, there is a blush of youthful desire, and the rosy red light of love hover over her warm cheeks and rising breast. And purple light or the rosy red light, which is actually a quality of young age, because love is a feeling which is ripe, which is it most in its prime condition when you are young. And when we grow up and when we have experiences in life, this feeling, it diminishes, and the love has been replaced. But when we are young and when we are in love, we have a kind of blush over our faces, we have a kind of attraction on our faces. So these are again they are controlled, these things, these emotions are controlled by the movement of this poetry or music. So music has the quality to control all kind of emotion, whether they are emotions of love, whether they are emotion of desires, whether they are emotion of frantic passions, or the emotions which are carrying passions that are blooming with the war laden movements, etc. So these are all the powers of music. And here ends the first part of the poem Progress of Poesy. In the next in the next lecture, we will take the second part and we'll discuss the stanzas of second part. Thank you very much.